My name is Dr Muhuthan Thillai. I'm a chest physician and the lead for the interstitial lung unit in Cambridge. We're based at the Royal Papworth Hospital. So what is sarcoidosis? That's a very difficult question to answer because the honest answer is we don't know. It's a disease that primarily affects the lungs in over 90% of cases, but it can affect almost any organ in the body, the skin, the eyes, the heart, the brain, and we don't know what causes it. We think it's something from the environment, but you end up with these clumps of tissue called granulomas in the lungs and other organs. And as the granulomas get bigger, they start to destroy the lungs, and that's how people become sick with the disease. We don't know what causes it. It's quite challenging to diagnose, and it can be quite tricky to treat as well. So what causes sarcoidosis? We don't know. We do know that there are lots of groups of people who are at higher risk of sarcoidosis, so it can run in families. Certain ethnic groups are at higher risk, and people who work in certain jobs, so people who work outdoors as farmers or with industry and dust, are always at higher risk of sarcoidosis. So we think it's related to something they've inhaled into the lungs, and the body forms an odd immune reaction to it, and that causes the disease. We know that when we look at lymph nodes in the lungs, we find higher percentages of certain bugs, either tuberculosis type bugs or another bug called propionibacterium bacterium, and so we think they may have a role in causing sarcoid, but the actual disease itself may be triggered by these things, but the disease is the body's response, which goes a bit haywire and causes these granulomas or clumps of tissue. So how is sarcoidosis diagnosed? Again, that's very tricky. Sometimes we just simply take scans of people, and we might do a chest x-ray and a CT scan and say, well, actually, that's enough. We're confident of diagnosis. But most of the time, we actually need to do a biopsy to be absolutely sure. So that might be a biopsy of the lung or a biopsy of a different part of the body. And when we do those biopsies, we find these very typical non-caseating granulomas. And we say that if we've excluded other things like tuberculosis or certain cancers, we then say, having excluded everything, that sarcoidosis is therefore a diagnosis of exclusion. And the biopsies often give us that answer. What are the main symptoms of sarcoidosis? They're very varied. So some people are lucky and they have a very brief period of illness and then are well for the rest of their life. In other people, the disease can be absolutely catastrophic. It can cause lung disease with lung scarring and lung fibrosis, putting people into respiratory failure. It can cause heart disease. The symptoms are breathlessness and chest pain and palpitations. And as the disease affects different parts of the body, it can cause problems in those parts of the body. And the symptoms are very variable. They're either from the organ that's affected, so the lung, for example, or people get general symptoms. Lots of our patients are very tired, and that can be a really horrible thing. They have sleep disturbances, and they generally don't feel well. So sarcoid can cause all sorts of problems. Okay, how is sarcoidosis treated? Some people don't need any treatment. Once you've made a diagnosis, you simply monitor them and they get better by themselves. Other people do need treatment, and this is usually in the form of drugs that we call immunosuppression. These may be steroid tablets, or we have much stronger drugs if the steroids don't work or if we want to give people stronger treatment. We also need to treat the affected part of the body. So for example, if they have heart sarcoid, they might need heart medications. If they have bone or calcium type sarcoid problems, you might need medications to change that. So the drugs can be very varied, and sometimes it's very complicated to make decisions about the different types of drugs that patients need. What is the outlook for sarcoidosis patients? This is very variable. So when you get sarcoidosis and you're young and it's acute, quite often patients are well. More than 90% of patients are disease-free by the end of the year. But sometimes when you get sarcoidosis and you're a bit older and it causes lung problems, then patients may need medication for life, and some patients sadly get progressively worse despite what you do. What advice would you give to a patient newly diagnosed with sarcoidosis? I think I'd say that it's a very difficult and complicated disease, but there are lots of great pieces of information out there. So Sarcoidosis UK obviously has a lot of great patient information. I'd emphasize they should talk to their doctor, and if they're worried in any way, they should always ask for a second opinion. I think as doctors, we're confident with our colleagues giving us advice as well. And sarcoidosis can be a challenging disease, and if you have a very difficult form of sarcoidosis, it is important that you're seen by someone who's an expert in that area. What is cardiac sarcoidosis? Cardiac sarcoidosis is simply when sarcoid affects the heart. And this can happen in three very different ways. So Firstly, we know that patients with sarcoidosis are at high risk of heart disease, ischemic heart disease and heart failure. We don't really know why. We think it's because sarcoid is a chronic condition and you have what are called inflammatory markers in the blood, and these cause high risks of heart disease. Secondly, a condition called pulmonary hypertension, and this is quite a complicated condition where the pressure of blood in the heart-lung circuit is higher than it should be. And this is can happen due to any lung disease, and when you have sarcoid and it affects the lungs quite badly, that back pressure on the heart-lung circuit causes pulmonary hypertension, and patients need specific medicines for that. And then thirdly and finally, cardiac sarcoidosis itself, which is where the granulomas, the clumps of tissue that cause sarcoid, are actually affecting the heart themselves. And that can affect the heart muscle, and it can also affect the electrical pathways in the heart, causing electrical problems. So those are the three ways in which the heart can be affected by sarcoid. I think that's very difficult. We don't have great data on the numbers of patients, but actually it's probably the first one that as patients get older and they have sarcoid, they end up having higher incidences of abnormal heart disease because of their sarcoid. There are less patients with actually cardiac sarcoid, but actually that's a bigger problem, and out of the three, that's probably the biggest problem to solve. So what percentage of patients with sarcoid have cardiac sarcoidosis? This is again is quite difficult to answer. We know from autopsy studies where patients have sadly passed away and doctors have looked at the heart, as many as half or two-thirds of patients might have cardiac sarcoidosis, so granulomas in the heart. But most of those patients are actually well. They pass away from something else. They just incidentally have these granulomas. The percentage of patients who have cardiac sarcoid that actually causes a problem is lower, but there are no great studies telling us exactly what percentage that is. Okay, so in what ways does cardiac sarcoidosis affect the heart? So I mentioned earlier the three types of heart disease, one of them being cardiac sarcoid itself, where the granulomas affect the actual heart. And you can imagine, if you think of the heart as an electrical circuit and impulses are fired from the top to the bottom, and this causes the heart muscle to contract, and that's your heartbeat, that's how your heart beats. If those granulomas affect those electrical pathways, then the electricity is not being conducted well throughout the heart, and that causes all sorts of problems. It can cause arrhythmias, which are abnormal heart rates, so your heart's going too fast or it's going out of sync, and it can cause heart failure. If the heart's not pumping quite as well, then the heart becomes slightly weaker. In terms of symptoms, patients experience a wide range of symptoms. So they may get chest pain, they may have palpitations where they feel their heart racing or they feel their heart out of sync, and very commonly they may get breathlessness. Not breathlessness because of the lung sarcoid, but breathlessness because of the heart. If the heart's not pumping quite as well, then patients do start to become short of breath. In terms of the telltale signs for cardiac sarcoidosis, sometimes it's unfortunately silent and patients are very well and they suddenly have a problem, and that's a very acute heart problem that we have to deal with, and there's no warning of that. But other patients gradually get heart problems, and one of the most important symptoms is breathlessness. So if patients find that they're more breathless than they used to be, and yet their doctor tells them that their lungs are relatively stable, then there is a worry that the breathlessness is coming from the heart. Other symptoms to watch out for are chest pains. People can get chest pains because of sarcoid in lots of areas, the lung and the muscle, but the heart itself can also cause chest pains and palpitations. If you feel your heart racing or you feel your heart skipping a beat, then that's definitely something you'd want to get checked out if you had a diagnosis of sarcoid. How is cardiac sarcoid diagnosed? Cardiac sarcoidosis can be very difficult to diagnose. We know that sarcoid itself is complicated, but cardiac sarcoid is even more complicated. The reason for this is that the absolute definite test is a biopsy. In the same way we biopsy people's lungs, we do biopsies of the heart. But we don't do those that frequently because, firstly, there's an increased risk of biopsying the heart. And secondly, the sarcoid in the heart is often quite patchy, so there is a reasonable chance that you do a biopsy and you actually pick up normal heart tissue. So we therefore have to use surrogates and scans, and the two best types of scans we do are an MRI scan or a magnetic scan, where a patient lies in an MRI scanner and we look in very good detail at the heart. We inject a dye that goes around, and if different parts of the heart light up, then we think that they may have cardiac sarcoidosis. The other very good scan is a PET scan, where again, that's a type of CT, but we inject a type of glucose which is labeled in a special way that goes around the body and different parts of the heart light up. that often gives us a definite answer and says, yes, this is cardiac sarcoidosis. But again, the complicating factor is that other diseases, amyloidosis, for example, or certain cancers can sometimes light up on heart scans. We do use other more simple tests. We use ECG tracings. These are sometimes normal, but these are sometimes abnormal in heart sarcoid. We use 24-hour tapes and recordings of the heart, and we use echoes, so a jelly scan of your chest to look for abnormal heart problems. In general, we combine all of these tests together, and it does take a group of specialists to sit down and come up with a confident diagnosis of sarcoidosis of the heart. In terms of a heart biopsy, it's very rare that we do it. Here in Papworth, we're a very big heart centre, so we do heart biopsies, and we have occasionally done a heart biopsy for sarcoidosis, but that's only when we're at the absolute end and we've done lots of different scans and we're still unsure, and it's important we get a clear diagnosis. So we do heart biopsies, but they are relatively rare in cardiac sarcoid. What does being in remission for cardiac sarcoid mean? Well, most of our patients with acute cardiac sarcoid have an acute flare-up, and we find this on an MRI or a PET scan that they've got a hot heart, so the heart is quite acute. We give patients medicines such as immunosuppression and other cardiac medicines to try and dampen this down. And then we repeat the scans, and at some point, and it may be a long while, years down the line, the scans become cold, and then we can stop treatment. And at that point, we would say that if we followed up a patient with scans and they had no further activity and no further symptoms, that their cardiac sarcoidosis would be in remission. They would likely always have some disease of the heart, but the activity may have died down to a very low level. We use the word remission in that case. In terms of cure, I'd say that it's very unlikely that we could cure cardiac sarcoidosis. By the time you have granulomas or disease in the heart that needs treatment, we'd hope that we could treat you and get you off treatment, but if we repeated scans down the years, there would always be a very minor amount of heart damage, so the heart never goes back completely to normal. Can cardiac sarcoidosis be fatal? Unfortunately, it can. It can either be fatal through a sudden death. So we have sadly had patients who have either not had cardiac sarcoid or not even had a diagnosis of sarcoid itself. And through exertion or through sports, for example, they suddenly have a cardiac arrest and die. We also have patients who have progressive cardiac sarcoid where we've diagnosed it, we've given them very strong treatments, but despite the strongest treatments that we have, the heart becomes weaker and weaker, and sadly patients can die from cardiac sarcoid. In terms of the advice for the outlook, most of our patients with cardiac sarcoid, if they're diagnosed early and treated early, actually live very long and healthy lives. It's really like any other aspect of sarcoidosis, it's about making an early and accurate diagnosis and treating patients. And for that reason, with something as complicated as cardiac sarcoidosis, it's really important that patients are seen by specialists, both lung physicians and cardiologists, so that you can make treatment decisions together for those patients. So how do we care for sarcoidosis patients in Papworth? We see not just cardiac sarcoid, but all sarcoidosis patients at Papworth. And we have, we're lucky in that we have a relatively large team of consultants and specialist nurses. And sarcoidosis in Papworth comes under the umbrella of ILD, or interstitial lung diseases. And there are lots of different types of ILDs. Sarcoid is just one of them. But we try and see our patients with sarcoid in a very specific way. We see them. Often they're second opinions from other hospitals. We see them in clinic, and then we like to review all of their tests. So if they've had biopsies elsewhere, we'll get the biopsies in. If they've had scans, we'll get the scan sent to us. And we have what's called an MDT, or a multidisciplinary meeting, where we sit down as a team of specialists and we review the scans and the biopsies to be confident of the diagnosis, and then see if we need to alter the treatment plan. And this is not just for cardiac, we see lots of lung sarcoidosis patients as well. How many sarcoidosis specialists do we have at Papworth? So in terms of consultants within the ILD team who see sarcoidosis, we currently have 5 consultants, a mix of full-time and part-time, but we also have 2 very good specialist nurses who are often the first point of contact for our sarcoidosis patients with drug changes or side effects or monitoring, that we have a dedicated telephone line that patients can phone in between their clinic appointments for them. We also have dedicated radiologists and pathologists who are specifically expert in lung diseases such as sarcoidosis. How many sarcoidosis patients does Papworth see? The honest answer is I don't know. We seem to be seeing more and more every month. We get several referrals a week for sarcoidosis, and they're often from other hospitals and who'd like an opinion on the treatment or just some advice on treatment changes. We have a few hundred sarcoidosis patients in total that we see. Some of them we see quite frequently. Some of them we may only see once a year if we're quite happy with their treatment, and they'll get seen by their local hospital in between times. In Papworth, we're a tertiary centre for East Anglia, so most of our referrals are from the east of England, but we do, as our service has grown, have taken patients from all over, so not just from England and Wales and Scotland, but we've got patients specifically with sarcoidosis, for example, from the Channel Islands and parts of Europe. So as our team has grown, then our catchment area has grown a little as well. So when should a sarcoidosis patient ask for referral to Papworth? We're very happy to see patients not just from our region but from further afield, and often this is patients who want a second opinion. What I would suggest is that they speak to their own physician or their GP and ask them to write a letter. We all deal in different diseases, and in our team in Papworth, when we have things that we're unsure about, we refer on to colleagues as well, and we're happy to do that. And in the same way, I'd hope that most of our colleagues would be happy for us to provide another opinion. I'd always urge patients to go and ask their physician to refer to us, but if they want, they can ask their general practitioner to refer directly to us as well. How does Papworth work with other sarcoidosis centres across the UK to provide the best possible care? And the honest answer is that our network is not completely formalised. There are a few expert centres in sarcoidosis. We all know each other. We all work closely with each other on research projects. But in terms of a clinical network, we haven't yet fully established that. A group of us together are writing a clinical statement in sarcoidosis for the British Thoracic Society, which should hopefully be published soon. And as part of that, a group of seven or eight experts have got together to write that statement and try and improve our clinical network, because it is very important that we work together to improve patient care as best as we can. What do you think special about Papworth? I think I'm very fortunate to work in Papworth, and I trained in various different parts of the country. But the reason for me is that Papworth is one of the largest heart and lung centres in the country. And it's not so much the sarcoidosis team that I think is great here. It's actually all the other teams. We have great access to lung and heart transplantation, to specialists that work in pulmonary hypertension and sleep medicine, and specialists who do bronchoscopy. So for me, one of the greatest joys of working in Papworth is the fact that we have fantastic colleagues in all of these different teams that we can rely on. And some of our sarcoidosis patients need lung and heart transplants. Some of them need specialists in pulmonary hypertension or sleep medicine. And we're lucky in Papworth in that we all work very closely together, and we can get really very excellent opinions from our colleagues specifically for our sarcoidosis patients.